we have the pleasure and the honor to have a session with the highest representative of European industrial policy at the European Commission. That's Kerstin Jorna. And
only slightly exaggerated.
Yeah, we have these commissioners who are sometimes floating around, but real policy is done by at DG GROW, of course, by the Director General. And it's for us very, very important because, as you can see there on the logos, there are one, two, four logos there. And one of them is the European Commission, the European logo, the European flag. Why? Because the Hydrogen Week is co-organized by lots of partners. And one of the co-organizers is the European Commission, is DG GROW. And we are very grateful. For the last 2 years, the Hydrogen Week has been nearly exclusively been organized by you. This year we went together. Last year's were without the exhibition. This year is with the exhibition. So we prepared basically what we can see outside there, real stuff to touch, to see, to smell, and it exists. So the hydrogen economy starts to kick off. Hydrogen production and technology production kicked off. I would like to give you the floor for your keynote and then to let you invite your panel, your distinguished panel. Ladies and gentlemen, Kerstin Jorna.
Thank you very much, Yorgos. And of course, DG GROW is also the team that's here also in the room. Now, as a keynote, I didn't want to repeat everything you already knew. I wanted you to change perspective in two ways. So way number one, I don't know who has the slides. Is that me? Any of the first slide?
Can we put the slide?
Slide number one. No, that's not slide number one. That's slide number two. Forget it. This one, yes. So what I want to say first is that when we talk about hydrogen, it's not enough. Because hydrogen is part of a bigger solution. And that's what we call the 24/7 solution. Because if you look at the off-takers, the demand side, the industry, what they want is hydrogen for their feedstock or a 24/7 affordable and green energy solution. Now, that means a lot of things, and hydrogen is part of that. It means solar and wind, but it also means intermittence. You have to solve that intermittence problem, the base load. Where does that have to come from? And that's where we need the technologies, and that's where we need hydrogen as storage, as vector. That's where we also need to be able to think about transport of hydrogen. And so when we talk about hydrogen, we also have to think in the perspective of those who are the off-takers and how we set the whole system up that there is this 24-hour affordable and green energy solution. That's perspective number one. Perspective number two is the second slide. Yeah, is the business case. And I must say, having talked to quite a number of you in the last days, it feels a bit like, you know, this Paul Simon song, 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover. Because people are thinking, the IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act in the US, you know, is this not a better business case there? And what should we not move to the US? Now, I would like to say, don't leave your lover in Europe. And I would like to just walk around this slide, which shows you there's a great business case for hydrogen in Europe. And I mean, let's start with investment. Now, if you add up the investment that member states have already agreed to in the projects for common interest, if you look at the money that's being dedicated to hydrogen in and renewable in the recovery and resilience plans, we're at 55 billion and still going on. Now, if you compare that with the IRA, I think $12 billion, $13 billion, you just see some dimensions. If I move on, for example, to the infrastructure, we have a huge pipeline of projects. We collected more than 1,000 projects from the Alliance and the whole value chain for hydrogen, demand and supply. And we are really making them happen. If we look at single market, we've set out to give a regulatory framework. Now, I know it's still work in progress, and some of you rightly say it's not fast enough, but we're getting there. But we're the first to actually have set out a regulatory framework, and I do want to underline that, you know, net neutrality, CO2 neutrality by 2050 and minus 55 by 2035 is law. And that's only in Europe that you have that. Also, when it comes to rolling out these hydrogen solutions, you need technical standards, how to do it. What's the purity of hydrogen that you need for certain industrial operations? How do you transport it? What's the security aspect? We've set out with a new standardization strategy, which is part of the Alliance, to actually develop these standards in very fast time. And don't say standards always take too long and it's always gray-haired men. It's not. It's now very dynamic, and we are also talking with the international standardization organizations to be in there. Blueprint for skills. Obviously, you need people to be part and to do this, workers, this new hydrogen economy. And we're financing a blueprint for skills for hydrogen workers under the Erasmus II project. When it comes to public perception, we have the Great Alliance, which is 1,700 participants now. There are loads of hydrogen valleys in Europe, and they are kind of developing by the day, where also local communities get engaged, which is really important. So if you look at these eight, this is eight reasons to stay in Europe. Now, in conclusion, there's a strong business case for hydrogen in Europe. Never mind that the US also want to have a strong business case, but because the more we have decarbonization of the industry, the better for our planet. But in Europe, you have very mature project pipelines as well. And in Europe, you have an approach that goes supply and demand. This is not the approach of the IRA. We're looking at the synchronization for the hydrogen supply and demand for the hydrogen economy, for example, via the Hydrogen Bank. And the Vice President already told you what we are working on it. So my conclusion is, with Paul Simon, don't slip out the back, Jack. Hop on the bus, Gus. You don't need to discuss much. Thank you. And I would now like to invite my panel to come to discuss the business case in Europe. Thank you. I have to be here because of the we do a center of gravity. We do a female center of gravity here. Okay. I'm very happy to introduce you to the members of my panel. Hildegard Bentele, she's a member of the Parliament, of the European Parliament, and has been a rapporteur both on the strategy for raw materials and also on the hydrogen strategy. Raphael Thilot is Executive President Renewables and Hydrogen of John Cockerill. And Cockerill is also a member of the European Clean Hydrogen Alliance and member of our electrolyzer partnership as well. Valerie Ruiz Domingo is Vice President ENGIE Group Hydrogen, and also ENGIE is a member of our Alliance and also of our Mobility Roundtable and the Standards Working Group. Thank you for that. And then we have Thomas Malango. He is the director at Repsol, Renewable Fuels and Circular Economy, and also president of the Spanish Hydrogen Network. Thank you very much for joining. And I'd like to have a little conversation around several topics. One is the question of ensuring enough hydrogen supply. Because when you talk to off-takers, the different industry, they say, will there be enough hydrogen for feedstock and for stabilizing the energy system? So I'd like to ask you, Thomas, the skyrocketing natural gas prices are bringing the price of hydrogen from steam methane reforming close to the price of hydrogen from renewable energy. Is there a way that we as policymakers can accelerate that kind of shift to the renewable?
Okay, thank you, Christian, and good afternoon to everyone. Of course, yes. I think that the current situation of the energy sector is giving us an opportunity to accelerate from the perspective of the regulators, of course. I think, and it has been said, I think, since yesterday, what we need is, I will say, to set up a clear rules of what hydrogen, renewable hydrogen or low carbon hydrogen means. I think I will say from the industrial perspective, this is the most important piece that we need to make our decisions from to invest and to move forward with the projects. And because the other things that have been done, I say, and it's important to remember that a lot of things have been done in Europe, have you been explaining before, like creating this Fit for 55 package and all the environment for that. And in the case of Repsol, working in Spain, where there is also a national roadmap with a significant ambition. So I would say that having clear rules to make sure which is the framework and the uncertainty that we have to play with, which is the market uncertainty, and I think we can deal with that because it's pretty common in the energy sector, but what we need is a clear definition to step up and to start working on executing the projects.
Thank you. Clear rules. Valerie, how can policymakers and hydrogen producers ensure that off-takers have access to supply and that off-takers actually trust you to do this investment and give you these long-term contracts?
Yeah, that is a very good question indeed, because we know that to get hydrogen, first of all, we need renewables if we want to have renewables hydrogen. So I think the first case will be really to have to be sure that we will get enough renewables. That really, I will say, so we know that we have some discussion, for example, regarding to have a part of the renewable dedicated to hydrogen. That could be also one first solution. The second one, I think that if we want to be sure, we have to speed up and to scale up. So I think that this morning I heard a lot of scale up, speed up, but I think I can really share this idea that we need really now to be pragmatic. And so we have to have all the mechanism, the regulation, the grants, and so the financing, and to be pragmatic and to finance directly the project. Like this, we will be sure to have this production of renewable hydrogen. And I think that I like what you said at the beginning, because you said about, you were referring to infrastructure. And that, for me, it's also so important to have some pipe dedicated to hydrogen, just to make the link between industrial hubs, for example, but also the consumption of hydrogen. So we will really need some pipes. And we will need also to have dedicated underground storage, because as you said before, it will be compensate the intermittency of the renewables. So it's all the value chain, I will say, that we need to develop and to make this production of hydrogen really happen now. And so it's why we really ask to also focus on infrastructure to be sure that all of us will have the market, the fluidity of the market, and to be sure that the off-taker will be also part of the game, I will say. And I think that with the repower EU. They say that there will be in 2030 20 million tons of hydrogen, half 50% coming from our own production and 50% coming from imports. And I think it's also a clue on that to be ensure that the off-taker, if they are taking long-term commitment, they will be sure to have hydrogen production. So, so really we need to speed up to be pragmatic and don't forget the infrastructure for hydrogen if we want really to have a liquidity market and to be sure that the off-taker will be also ready to commit.
Can I ask how many off-takers are in the room? You are too few. Well, maybe you can reserve for the question for the Q&A session. I'll move to Rafael because you are in the Cockerill is in the electrolyzer business. Do you think we can do it, or are there issues that are lacking, or you would wish for more help or support in increasing that electrolyzer capacity?
I would say that the technology is there. Technology is there, is mature. I guess one of the key questions for my segment of the chain, being an OEM, a manufacturing designing electrolyzer, is can we provide enough volume to supply our clients fast enough? And there, I can tell you about what we do at John Cockerill. I do not know what the entire industry and my competitors are doing. What I can tell you is that on our side, we are trying our best to accelerate. We had started about 2 years ago to develop one gigafactory in Europe, in France and in Belgium. After quite some iteration, we are today very grateful to have been notified by the IPCEI. So we are now accelerating and we aim to start this gigafactory between France and Belgium by the end of next year. Now, when we look at the demands and when we hear all clients coming to us, it looks like one factory will not be enough. And this is where the EU can help. We, as a private industrial, we can either wait and make sure the demand will indeed materialize, and then we go ahead. We start developing a new factory, or we anticipate. To help us anticipating, having another IPCEI-alike scheme may lead us to take, in the very short term, a decision for a second gigafactory in Europe. Now, outside Europe, we are also doing what we can. Our target is 8 gigawatts of manufacturing capacity by the end of 2025. It's 2 in Europe and 6 outside Europe. We should keep in mind that this is a global market. You mentioned IRA, which I believe is both an opportunity for technology companies of Europe and also a threat. Because at the end, there is limited number of people with the right expertise. Capital, there is quite some capital around. I am more concerned about the supply chain and the people. So I think the Europe has done a really good job to get started. We are ahead in Europe. And I would like to really thank the EU for what you have done, but it's not enough. The end game is not what has been achieved. The end game is still ahead of us, and we need to continue making things more simple. The IRA has a beauty of being very simple. We need to continue making things more simple and continue accelerating.
But, I mean, if I look at the IRA and just the two numbers I quoted, the 12 billion, I think, and the 55 billion, you know, why do people find 12 billion more simple than 55? I don't really understand that. But maybe it really means that in the way we are doing it, we have to be more lucid. Or more clear, because we're not only paying for the output, we are paying for the whole value chain, including the raw materials, and making sure that we have an ecosystem that functions, not only an output. I think that's the biggest difference. But I really like what you say, Europe is ahead of the game, let's keep it that way. Could I ask you to Hildegard, from the European Parliament point of view and the rulemaker point of view, where do you see improvement possible or good messages to give back to the industry? We're getting there.
Well, I think we have made a good way, and I think the European Parliament was certainly
the one who was pushing to be faster, to be more simple with regard to regulation. We are still on in the process is still ongoing, but I think we made our stance, and I think even we had the pandemic, it was a stumbling point, but we overcame it, I think, pretty fast. I think all the legislation is on time, and it's certainly not the parliament who is prolonging or not taking decisions. So, and we are really working on having the whole strategy, and as you mentioned, raw materials, since I'm also the raw materials rapporteur, I'm very glad that this dimension is also now taken into consideration, since many industries are currently under risk to have longer production delays. For example, the automotive industry has now really delays about half a year because of raw material risks in their supply chains. And I very much embrace that the Commission now comes up with a legislative proposal to really tackle this in a very comprehensive way. I think Parliament and the Commission in this regard are really on one line, and I think reinforcing each other, I would call it like that.
Valérie, if you hear Raphael saying that there's enough money, do you share that point of view for rolling out, or and do you think that it's not the money, it's just, you know, the overall framework that needs to be clearer for investors?
I think it's not the only thing. I think that when you see all the communication regarding the different funds, you are referring to the 55 billions. So it's a lot of amount of money. So, but I think that now we have, when I said before that we have to speed up, is that now we have to become pragmatic and to grant the project just in order to set up and to set up the market, because otherwise, so it's one issue, but I think that we have enough money just now to allocate the right project to be in order to have this kind of production. And for sure, the second one is I think that we need now really to have this kind of visibility on the regulation. I think that it was a very long process. And I think that I know that right now there is a trilogue between the Commission, the Parliament, and the Council. But we really need now to have something. I don't know if it's a delegated act, if it's a red three, I don't know which one. But really, and to coming back to your first question regarding the off-takers, I think that if we want, if we don't have right now this kind of visibility, I think that we will spend years and years waiting, and maybe the US will come, even if they have only 12 billion, I will say, of dollars, maybe it will be the game changer in a way that people will be maybe I will say fed up of waiting, and they will go on to see other countries, and maybe the US could be one possibility. And after that, we will see a lot of H2 exports to Europe coming from outside. So I think financing is not the only part, but I think the visibility on regulation now have to be set up. I don't think that we can wait for months and months again.
Hildegard, you want to comment on the latest state of play, maybe?
Well, as I said, I mean, I subscribe to the fact that we need fast and pragmatic regulation, but I think we have an understanding on that. I mean, I'm called every week about new projects, and I'm also in contact with the Commission. You know, this project is not envisaged by the current regulation, so can we have some free space? Can we move on? Not to regulate everything until the very end, but to have a start and maybe to sharpen later on if you see that there is a lack of regulation, but to get this start. But I think, I mean, my feeling is, from my the conversation we're having, the Parliament was pushing hard, but I think we have this common understanding that we are really, we could be too late, but I think we are not yet too late.
No.
And I think the framework is in place, and we have a comprehensive framework. I would underline this. We have projects, we have the finance, we have the regulation. We have also the idea of importing to have the global market, and we are working on the standards. So I think the understanding and the awareness is there, and I think it's more comprehensive than the US, which is mainly working with throwing a lot of money into hydrogen. So, but I mean, I think we are more comprehensive, and hopefully on the long term, then also we have the whole value chain on our mind. And I think this is crucial, I mean, to make also this technology, keep this technology a European asset?
Thomas, you're the president of the Spanish Hydrogen Network. Do you have similar discussions in the more kind of national context? Do you advance more? How would you, if you compare the two discussions, Spain and Europe?
Well, I think Spain feels that it's a great opportunity for the country to contribute to the hydrogen development in Europe. So probably the conversations are quite similar. I agree with what you were saying regarding the Inflation Reduction Act. I think that Europe is still ahead because the conversation has been deeper and for longer term. So probably the opportunity is more structured in Europe and Spain particularly, which is very much aligned with the European strategy. But it's a kind of call for action, I think, I will say. So we need to move forward because the other regions are moving. And if we don't make our final decisions and start making it happen, making it physical, and getting some learnings there to make it more competitive, we will be catch up by other regions. So I think we still have some room to keep the pace and keep the leadering, but we have to be aware that other people are not, they are not sleeping, they are doing their job, and they are catching up. So from a Spanish perspective, I think Spain is very well aligned for the energy strategy with the European Commission and with the European Union entirely. And our company and our ecosystem, which is more or less up to 50% of the Spanish targets included in this ecosystem, is absolutely aligned with that. So I would say we are keep working on the projects, just the same like everything was already done. So at some point we will end up with the final investment decision, and then we hope that the rules will be there to jump in.
Soon, I hope. May I ask the off-takers who are in the room? I saw two or three. Would any of you be ready to give his perspective or her perspective? It's difficult to see with the light in the eyes. Would you be ready, for example, to do a 5-year contract, supply contract, 10-year? Anyone ready to come out?
None of them.
Off-takers, you're really shy. I mean, you're part of the equation. Well, I hope to see you next time. Well,
yeah. In my case,
you speak now for the off-takers.
I will give a time for the other one to think a little bit about. as a company that I'm going to be a producer and an off-taker, I will say that I understand that it's difficult to sign a contract without something doesn't have a clear definition and a clear price. So when you have to sign a contract, maybe you can sign an MOU, you can sign something like an intention to buy. But when you want to buy a product, you need a price formula and a clear definition of what is the boundaries of the product. So it's difficult for the off-takers to sign. In my case, my off-taker, which is the downstream business, the chemical and the refining business, almost they will be obliged to sign because it's an internal business. But even though that it is an internal business, the conversation is there because they say, oh, how am I going to pay? How much am I going to pay for the hydrogen? What is the green hydrogen? Is it going to be useful in this condition that you're going to produce it to meet the renewable energy directive conditions? So we need, I think it's a kind of chicken egg problem. We need to close up. Even it's not perfect, and you have explained that very well. We need to close up some definition. Then you will make the contracts, and then everything start to move on, and we will have time to correct it if it's not perfect.
Would the hydrogen bank help, Valérie?
Yeah.
In what way would you see it help?
I think that he has to be something simple. So I don't know how they will. I will say they will match with, for example, the H2 global platform. I said that it will be very important to know what will be the link between what will be the organization, because I think that for ENGIE, I think that the H2 Global platform, it's a very useful tool. And I think that it will really to promote the different projects and to finance them. And so that is no issue for us, but the link between the European Bank missing with the H2 Global platform, I don't know. So now we, I think that we need really to have this kind of detail when I said before that we need to be pragmatic. I think that we have to simplify the process. Just coming back on the IPSAE, for example, it's a process that is too long, too heavy. It takes time for many things. So when you are dealing with this kind of process, you are not focused at all on all the project to see on the whole creative value chain and how you create. You can focus on electrolyzer manufacturer and so on. But we really need to have this visibility and to be pragmatic, to have very short, simplify, I will say, process to be sure that the market will really raise now and to speed up and to scale up.
But what I understand from those who like the IRA and also from what you say is if we had a price, then we could move on. How do you think that would kind of help to define a price for the market?
Well, it will be, for example, I will say it would be the price. If we take the H2 global platform, it will be a mix between the demand and the offer. Mm. So it will be the simple economical way of doing business. So I think that with this kind of signal, it will be possible, for example, to know if in Europe we will be able to produce hydrogen renewable affordable price, because when I said at the beginning that we need renewables, we knew, of course, we need also to have a sourcing, the cheapest way to have a decrease of hydrogen renewable cost, mm. because otherwise you wouldn't get any project. So I suppose that the price for the off-taker, it's one part of the chicken and eggs that you said before, but I say that really we need to focus now on this kind of simplify the mechanism and to get the grants for the right project.
Get the market matching.
Yeah, I think so. I think that demand and offer, and we will see the right price at the right place. But I think that for Europe, it's very urgent now to act in this way, I think.
Raphael, I'd like to move to one other area, which is raw materials. Now, producing electrolyzers requires certain not so frequent raw materials, or raw materials that are not in Europe. Do you see that as a challenge to the scale-up of the electrolyzer production?
A challenge, certainly. I would say provided we have enough time to anticipate, we will succeed, I would say. And I mean, the previous discussion is very important because it gives certainty to our clients, to the downstream part of the chain, and then these clients of us, they come to us. And today we are in discussion with some investors willing to reserve capacity, not for one project, but for about a portfolio of projects, let's say from 2024 to 2028. And this certainty, they can provide it to us because they have themselves certainty about the scheme, the subsidies, and so on, in which they will invest. Thanks to this certainty, we can go ahead and invest in new manufacturing capacities. We can work on the supply chain. We can enter into long-term supply agreements with suppliers of certain components and certain raw material. Now, to close on my answer, I would say that the alkaline electrolyzer technology is far more simple and less dependent upon rare earths, rare materials. We had some concern about nickel. Following the Ukraine dramatic event, the nickel price went to the roof. Today, it's back to where it was before the crisis. So nickel was a concern. I wouldn't say that beyond nickel there are no challenges, but we are far less dependent than PEM on specific material. Mm-hmm. So I want to be positive here. As long as we get organized, this will not slow down the development.
That's at least, that's a very good news then. Are there questions from the room you want to ask the panelists? Sorry, I can only indicate, yes. Can you say your name as well and your organization?
Yes. Thank you. My name is Marta Lovisolo. I work for Bellona Europa Climate NGO. I wanted to ask MEP Bentele, So everybody's in the room is asking for having a framework in place as fast as possible. So why did the European Parliament, and in particular the EPP and the German delegation you're part of, vote for Amendment 13 that actually made it completely vain all the work that the Commission and everybody did to actually have in place a framework for green hydrogen from the end of the year, and now we're looking at 27 potential different frameworks starting from 2024. Thank you.
Is there another question? Because then we take both of them. I don't see any. Hildegard, you want to go?
It's hard to understand because of the volume, but I think you mentioned the red amendment 13, which was certainly not intended to split it up in 27 national regulations, but to push for a more pragmatic and for more simple criteria. And I think this was this was widely requested by the industry. So that's what I understood. And I think as it found a majority, it's also widely shared by many colleagues. And I think that was what I mentioned when we were pushing the Commission, because the current condition would just lead to the fact that many projects would not fly, and we would have to wait for them much longer. So this was our intention. Not any other. It was not to make the thing more cumbersome, but more pragmatic. And this was the view which was widely shared until now, but we can discuss this bilaterally, what was maybe not so favorable in this with this decision.
As part of the industry, I fully support. I agree that we need a regulation, and we need it fast, but it needs a minimum amount of freedom to make the projects run. Some of the proposals that we have been working on the last year and a half wasn't jeopardizing the opportunity. So, yes, we need something fast, but there are some minimum requirements to make the projects run. Maybe we don't need to go to Inflation Reduction Act, but maybe we don't need to do the most complicated regulation. Mm-hmm. So we fully support and agree with the amendments that have been released by the Parliament.
I share. I totally agree with both of you, because I think that we don't need right now, if we want to have the market, to have this liquidity and to have really this production, we don't need to have, I will say, over-regulated, because maybe one day it will appear, it will come, I am sure it will come, but not yet. I think that the most, I would say, primary thing is that we need to have this kind of market, and maybe in 2030 we could have this criteria, additionality, temporality, regionality, but for the moment we need to create this market. So no more over, I think that no over regulation will be needed. Yeah.
There was one more question, I'm sorry, I didn't see you. Blinded by the light.
Of course. Hello, Leonard Puttbeck from Hey Corporate Affairs. My question, I think, mostly would go towards Ms. Bentele and Mr. Malango. My question is, how do you see the current, let's say, trajectory between the amount of renewable energy capacity we have, electrolyzer capacity, and the ambitions set now by Repower EU and RED III? Because you already highlighted, we need, of course, speed up the permission process for renewables. We clearly are lacking behind with electrolyzer production. But if we look at current estimates, simply to decarbonize a single major steel plant, so to say, with hydrogen, would require often more renewable capacity than might be available in that member state. So in short, simply, what concrete measures, apart from making renewable permission faster, supply and demand concerns, what are concrete measures that you see to actually solve this asymmetry between ambitions and the realistic capacity that we have?
Well, I mean, we were pushing very much for a vision which encompasses the global aspect, because at the beginning, I might be wrong, but the Commission and also Member States were very much looking just on Europe, on to produce renewable energy just in Europe, which was certainly not enough, and not fast enough, and not affordable enough. So we were very much pushing to have to take into consideration the global aspect. This is why we also pushed very much to have this H2 platform, that we have long-term contracts, because I'm also sitting in the development committee. We have many African partners who ask, we would like to produce hydrogen, but can we sell it to you? So So of course they ask for this security, for this planning security, for this investment security. So we need these instruments, and I think that's very crucial that we look where is the renewable energy unlimited and most affordable. So that's not in Europe currently, or maybe just in some places. That's not, I think we really not look need to look global, and this is what we were pushing for very much, and I think we should continue pushing for that. And we should also look now at the transport. It was mentioned infrastructure transport, which is very crucial. We are currently discussing the gas package, but we are also discussing how can we transport the ships, how can we fuel the ships in a way that it continues to be climate neutral, that it doesn't get a minus business at the end. And we also have to look, and I think this is why it's reasonable. I mean, we can also decarbonize steel industry in South Africa. I mean, this is also something, there's a win-win situation, and we push for the expansion of renewables abroad. I think that's also from a, climate perspective, international justice perspective, it's a good one. So it has a lot of potential, and this is what we see as the step we have to take.
Want to come in?
Yes. An addition on that, and very specifically for Spain, the pipeline of renewables is enough to make the hydrogen that is needed for the Spanish needs and to export. Therefore, the question is regarding the permitting. In the case of Spain, that is clear that it can be done. We only need to decrease the time of the permitting and to get the infrastructure to export the hydrogen to the north of Europe.
Okay, I'm afraid we come to the end of this panel a bit, but I want to ask one last question to the panelists, and only maximum three words. I'll start with Thomas. You can think. Hydrogen economy in Europe is?
The greatest opportunity.
Hydrogen economy in Europe is?
Opportunity, but we have to speed up.
Hydrogen economy is,
I would say, once in a lifetime change for European technologies.
Hydrogen economy is in Europe?
Will be thriving.
And I would close by saying hydrogen economy in Europe is a business case. Thank you very much for all of you.
Many thanks. Many thanks to all of you. Many thanks, Kerstin, for leading the panel, and I think we got some clear ideas on how industry is evolving from the industry as such and from political decision makers. I would like to allude to one point, that's the electrolyzer partnership. And I would like to thank Kerstin, especially you, because you were driving this to put together after RepowerEU was published. We understood, wow, we need to build up electrolyzers by a factor of more than 100. Wow, within 7 years. And that was an immediate action for DG Grow, for the Commission, and for yourself. So we brought together also Cockerill as one of the leading companies. We brought together, I think, 23 CEOs from continental Europe, I have to say. And then we started to build this up in a partnership, in a pre-competitive partnership. And this goes really with you. Thanks to you, and I would like to also pass on to you this wonderful book, Heroes of Hydrogen. Here in these pictures that you see in this book, there are already two electrolyzer companies represented. I don't say which ones, you cannot read it, but it's two different ways, and you see how the industry evolves and how it's made by human beings. It's not something that happens by falling from the sky, as your commissioner would sometimes say. It doesn't fall from the sky. It needs to be done by people, and they build it up, and lots of efforts need to be done. Thanks very much to you, to all of you, and thanks to this panel on industry. While you are, so to say, leaving the stage, I would like to allude to the next topic. After discussing industry, we need to discuss some fundamental issues that make industry work. That's standards, that's certificates, that's the question of how green is the hydrogen. I'm very happy that we have Bellona here, that we have an NGO here, being a watchdog on the cleanliness, on the renewable character of hydrogen, on how this can be decarbonized. And this is something that the hydrogen industry is keenly looking into. We are eager to come up with standards that are fit for global use, and we started quite early to do that under a title called Certify. And today we would like to discuss where we are at the global level, and there is no better to discuss that with us than our global partner, that's the Hydrogen Council. And I would like to welcome here on stage Daria Nocevnik, who is the leading European face of the Hydrogen Council, which is a club of CEOs on a global level. And you have made a study on that. It's not 100% done, but the main objectives of the study are ready to be presented today. And that's what you will do.
Looking forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Daria.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be joining you today at this flagship Hydrogen Week here in Europe. As Jorgo mentioned already, the Hydrogen Council is a global coalition of CEOs that brings together the industrial leaders across the value chain and across geographies. We work with companies and governments in the Americas and the Asia Pacific, in Africa, and of course in Europe. So it's great to be joining today our European hydrogen champions and our European hydrogen family. As Jorgo mentioned already, we have been working very closely with our international partners on a dedicated project and looking at robust and tradable certification schemes for hydrogen. And we are very pleased to have Hydrogen Europe as a member of the advisory board to the project, together with our international partners that include the International Energy Agency, International Renewable Energy Agency, and of course, our partners with WBCSD, the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. This work on hydrogen certification forms part of the work in the Council that we do under our hydrogen sustainability program. So many of you probably know the Council from the techno-economic assessments and the studies that we have been publishing, the Hydrogen Insights report that captures the status quo in terms of the development of the hydrogen industry globally, as well as our latest hydrogen trade flow study that looks at the evolution of hydrogen trade flows and the development of hydrogen trade corridors by 2030 and all the way to 2050. Now, of course, when we are talking about hydrogen trade and in Europe, Europe has set a very bold vision for importing some 10 million tons of hydrogen by 2030 and working together with international partners, building trade corridors, the North Sea corridor, the North Africa corridor, and of course the corridor of hydrogen imports from Ukraine when it would be possible to unlock that. And when we talk about trade and developing those cross-border exchanges, making sure that a unit of hydrogen and those cross-border exchanges are based on a common set of rules and standards and are enabled by hydrogen certification is absolutely key. So in our, and this is very much the core of the sustainability program that we have in the Council. So we work on facilitating the development of common industry standards to assess sustainability attributes of hydrogen. And I'm going to talk about carbon footprint in particular. We're also working on the assessment of the regulation of sustainability attributes of hydrogen across jurisdictions, as well as certification. And this is where our roadmap comes in. And the SDG dimension of the development of the hydrogen economy. So how can hydrogen projects contribute in a meaningful way to the UN Sustainable Development Goals, both in emerging market economies and in developed countries? And we're also working on reporting and disclosure standards for hydrogen. So when it comes to certification, it is, of course, quite a puzzle. And we find that these days, when there is a discussion on certification, oftentimes the different stakeholders tend to talk about certificates, standards, labels, and use these terms interchangeably. So one of the the first challenges and the first objectives that we have when we talk about certification is to make sure that when we're trying to solve this puzzle, we keep all the pieces of the puzzle in order and making sure that there is clarity on what instrument is designed for what purpose. So keep the, all the pieces of the puzzle on purpose and help fostering cross-border cooperation and building consensus. I've mentioned already the work on the international sustainability standards, in particular common standard methodology to assess the carbon footprint of hydrogen production and transportation pathways. Later today, I'll be delighted to join our partners with IPHE, Noe, our host, the chair of IPHE, International Partnership for Hydrogen Fuel Cells and the Economy, that developed an excellent and best practice guidelines, which will be updated shortly, on the assessment of, indeed, the carbon footprint of hydrogen production and transportation. And these guidelines are going to be fed into the ISO standard, so a standard, global common standard developed by the International Organization for Standardization. So the work at ISO level has already started, and already next year there will be a best practice methodology available for the early movers. And we see that work on a global common standard being crucial to inform the certification schemes for hydrogen, because of course there will be different thresholds and different labels used by different jurisdictions internationally. And unless there is one common way to assess the carbon footprint, regardless from where the hydrogen is produced, it would be difficult to compare these thresholds and to compare sort of the robustness of the different schemes that evidence that a given unit of hydrogen has a given carbon footprint. So this is where we are coming from when we are approaching the certification challenge. So standards being an important instrument to inform the certificate, and certificate, of course, being the means to evidence the sustainability attribute itself. So when it comes to the role of certification, and I'm sure that this is something that was mentioned by previous speakers throughout the day today, we see it as a critical instrument in order to be able to make sure that the sustainability attributes of hydrogen are evidenced in a way that is credible and sustained and consistent across different regions and geographies. It's also an instrument to build consumer trust, to basically be able to enable consumers to signal their demand for hydrogen, and certification schemes can be used to inform different types of support measures and different types of frameworks that incentivize hydrogen uptake across end users. And last but certainly not least, certification schemes are critical to enable that cross-border trade and the emergence of the trade corridors between Europe and the regions in the world, and of course allowing the market participants to unlock the value of hydrogen. You know, oftentimes hydrogen is, and the evolution of the hydrogen markets is compared to that of LNG, and it's important to distinguish and to identify one key difference, which is, of course, the value of LNG is contained in the value of the physical product. It's located in the value of the physical commodity, whereas in the case of hydrogen, the value of hydrogen is contained both in the value of the physical product and in the value of the certificate that is evidencing the environmental attributes. So we see the environmental attributes and certificate as an important value driver for hydrogen uptake across different geographies. So hydrogen certification can effectively serve different purposes, and we group them into two buckets, if you like. So regulatory compliance, meaning compliance with specific support schemes or specific frameworks that provide for incentives for hydrogen uptake. And there could be different compliance markets within a single jurisdiction. For example, in Europe, we have the emerging framework for CBAM and also the RED II requirements that are pending. And of course, certificates can also be used for reporting and disclosure purposes. And those include CSR and ESG reporting obligations that companies may want to evidence for their shareholders. When we look at the, so there are different types of purposes that schemes are designed to serve, but also we see that, of course, there are different types of attributes, and there are different types of hydrogen-based products that different types of consumers would seek to take up. And of course, this market type uptake of hydrogen and hydrogen-derived products across different end users will be largely different by the compliance systems that emerge in different geographies. And here you just have a snapshot of these different compliance frameworks that drive or are about to drive uptake by different end users across different products. Now, to add a little bit of complexity, and I'm not going to elaborate on this too much, but also compliance requirements within the different frameworks can be different, and they can be evidenced in a different way. So the methodology to evidence the specific compliance requirements also vary across different schemes and across different policy frameworks that emerge. So here you see a snapshot just indicating that a given framework, a given policy framework, may define compliance requirements as regards the carbon footprint, but also cover other criteria, including, for example, the community development, the social aspects, the sustainability of water and land use. So there are different schemes and there are different qualification requirements, and there are also different ways of assessing these qualification requirements. And specifically when it comes to the assessment of the carbon footprint of hydrogen production, we see that different jurisdictions are thinking of different pathways to do that and to form these methodologies. And this is why we think that the work that is done by IPHE is so crucial, and the pathway to development of one common global ISO standard is absolutely critical to inform the certification schemes across geographies. Now, of course, we see that already countries from Australia to UAE and Germany and other countries in Europe are thinking about developing their own hydrogen certification schemes. And that in itself is a great and it's very positive. The downside is that unless these schemes are aligned one way or another, that may translate into fragmentation of a global market. And this is where we're coming from with our work on a roadmap and a checklist for robust and tradable certification schemes for hydrogen. So assessing the landscape of what is out there and finding solutions for mutual recognition between schemes. So how can certification schemes for hydrogen talk to each other in practice? This is precisely the focus of our work of the roadmap and the checklist. And we have been looking at the core design features of the certification systems as regards, for example, governance and supervision and oversight, and looking at what are the best practices in terms of ensuring, for example, the double counting of certificates is avoided. And we have looked at the design of the schemes and how could a scheme cater for effectively different compliance markets. And as part of the study project that we are carrying out, we have identified the modular approach in scheme design as one of the most optimal ones when you have some core requirements and some core design features that, again, pertain to governance and oversight. And then you have some specific jurisdiction-specific requirements being plugged into the scheme, and that allows for that a level that would allow a scheme to serve different compliance markets across different jurisdictions. Now, moving from scheme design to the enabling framework, because of course that picture and that functionality is specific to the scheme design, but a scheme design is also referred to and enabled by national legislation across different jurisdictions. So we definitely see a crucial need for greater alignment when it comes to the development of legislative frameworks for hydrogen and specific provisions on hydrogen certification that are contained within those legislative frameworks, and in particular enabling that mutual recognition between schemes and the recognition of schemes that are developed in third countries in a given jurisdiction. So we are, these days, as we speak, we are finalizing the work on the roadmap and the checklist. So the roadmap will lay out solutions for mutual recognition between existing schemes, and the checklist is designed to provide a practical tool for national legislators. So if you are a national authority and you are tasked to develop a certification scheme for hydrogen, that tool can be your guidebook for looking at what are the key design features that can be adopted in order to make sure that your certification scheme is robust and it is tradable. And it's my great pleasure to be joined today by our colleagues and close collaborators. We have In a moment, I will be joined by Wouter van Hout from Initio, and we are delighted to be supported by Initio and LBST in the implementation of the study project, and we're very keen to share all the findings with you very soon in the coming month. With that, a big thank you, and I look forward to our panel discussion.
Many, many thanks. Yeah, please join. I just wanted to say thank you to Daria and to make ourselves understand how important this issue is. So it's super important. It's super competitive between the geographies. So we better run faster. But nobody knows that better than Wouter van Hout, who is basically the guy running the certified project from its early beginning. So it's a pleasure to have you, of course, together with Daria on this panel. It's your panel.
Thank you very much, Jorgo, for the nice words. I think we already had a very nice introduction made by Daria in order to demonstrate that international trade certification is far from easy because we see a certain fragmentation, and how will we deal with this in bringing this all together. And this is what this panel will be about. Allow me to introduce quickly the panel speakers. I think everybody already met Daria now. I met Daria more than 10 years ago, already being amazed by all the papers you were writing back in the days about LNG markets, how LNG trade was impacting geopolitics. So I think you have really the proper background in seeing how this exercise could also be repeated into the hydrogen world. Then we have Katrien Verwimp. Katrien Verwimp studied to be an engineer, and if I recollect correctly, you had to hide it in the past, but now you can be proud of it. Your master thesis was about hydrogen and fuel cells.
Exactly.
Afterwards, you joined the Vrech, so it's Flanders regulator of electricity and gas. There you've been responsible for renewable electricity GOs. And currently, you are working within the Association of Issuing Bodies. So this is the association that gathers all of the national appointed issuing bodies of renewable electricity. You've been helping a lot in its internal reform. You've been substantially contributing to them, also making a gas chapter. So you are currently coordinating the energy conversion activities. I call her Miss AIB. Whenever you have a technical question about guarantees of origin, please go and see Katrien. On my right, I have Noé van Hulst. I promised that I was not going to read all of his career because it will be already cocktail time. But Noé, you really have an international career. You started in the Dutch Ministry of Economics back in 88. You have been working in Riyadh in the International Energy Forum. You have a long last history with the IEA. You've been within Paris. Currently, you're the chair of IPHE. You are supporting also Gasunie. You've been a special envoy on hydrogen to the Dutch government. And let me really say, it has been great to have a national policymaker who's always been playing the European or the international card. I think you really bring in this global perspective, the geopolitics, and how hydrogen can become the next energy carrier of the future. So honored to have you here. And then finally, to my left, we have Peter Mackay. Peter Mackay from Air Liquide. You've been around a long, long time in London as an equity analyst. You've been working with, I would say, all of the big names. You've been joining around 2017 Air Liquide, VP Investor of Strategic Intelligence, and you've been co-chairing the Group on Energy Transition. Currently, you hold the position in Paris of VP Strategy and Policy Support. And I think, yeah, with Air Liquide being such an important actor in the hydrogen energy scene and having worked on it for such a long time, thank you for being here and contributing to this session. Good. So I'm going to start the session. By the way, I will be rather sharp, so we know exactly when it's cocktail time. I do promise you we'll stop on time. Maybe the first question to you, Noé, it's IPHE has engaged in the development of new carbon footprint methodologies. And those carbon footprint methodologies will serve as a basis of the new ISO standard coming up. It is also what has been showed by Ondaria's slides. But what's the background of this? Why did IPHE start this work? What's the gap that you detected? And how are you working to resolve it?
Okay. Good questions, Wouter. First of all, thank you very much for your very kind introduction. It's a pleasure to be here with you guys here. Although I have to say, my impression is that the real party is going on somewhere else. There's so much noise on the other side, but okay, we'll stay in our own panel discussion now. So the IPHE, I think the good news is indeed IPHE, which has a global perspective, because it basically, for those of you who don't know, it collects the G20 countries and the European Commission are member. So definitely all the regions. From an early day, I think probably was 3 years ago, they already identified that if we are talking about trading clean hydrogen around the globe, how on earth is this going to work if you cannot see, you know, what the hydrogen coming from Australia, what is the carbon footprint of that versus South Africa or the Middle East, or Chile was not even on the radar screen then. So early on they said, we need to start thinking about, you know, how do we calculate that? How do you calculate the carbon footprint? Because everybody was always talking and still talking about green hydrogen, blue hydrogen, and all the colors, which is wonderful for a public debate, but it's not useful to take any decisions on. So, and for instance, of course, Certify was already mentioned, your great work. As why don't we do, Europeans were saying in IPHE, why don't you go certify? And Australians said, no, this is not going to work for us. And that, for me, it was the wake-up call. And then a whole discussion started in IPHE of saying, no, we really need to do something where we bring all the players together and work on a common methodology. How do we calculate the carbon footprint from renewable hydrogen, but also from gas and CCUS, et cetera, different pathways. And we pushed very hard, I can tell you here. It was not easy to decide that, but finally we decided, and then the real experts came around the table from Japan, from the US, from the European Union, and started to work on, okay, can we design something that we can agree on? And I'm happy to say, and I don't take any credit for it, I was just there, you know, being the chairman, and receiving the good news that we have a consensus, we can propose a common methodology, and hopefully that can become a global standard at some point, because we're not a standard setting body, but we can pave the way as IPHE to have what they call a seed document into this process. So that was very very good news, but it's painstaking work, Wouter. And it's very important, but we're still only having the first foundation of the production of hydrogen. So now they are still working, this task force, on then how do you calculate the carbon footprint and can we propose something for that when you turn it into a carrier, either ammonia or liquefied or LOHC. And then, of course, you get how do you transport it from the product, from the producing exporting country to the importing country. What's the carbon footprint of that? So we'll be probably at the end of that road talking about spring next year, if everything goes right, summer next year, that we will have hopefully also a similar proposal that we can say, okay, this is how you can do it. And as Daria rightly said, it's only a stepping stone. We don't pretend to do anything more than, at least at the global level, propose a stepping stone upon which everybody else can hopefully usefully work. Sorry to be long, but
No, excellent and very complete answer. But already answered also my second question.
Okay, then you can move on to the next speaker.
So, Peter, so there's already one stepping stone that's being set now together with IPHE. They're doing a great job. There's also another discussion that we hear all the time, and that's a discussion book and claim versus mass balancing. In Air Liquide's vision, how are we going to do trade-off low carbon, clean, green, blue hydrogen? Should the molecule be shipped around to an end customer to claim the environmental attribute? Should the molecule be shipped physically to a certain continent, and can there be virtual trade thereafter in the continent or within a certain company? Or do you think that the certificates can be traded internationally without any physical molecule trade behind? What's the vision of Air Liquide?
Thanks very much for the question. I think it's very important that we actually start to see recognition of the environmental attributes and the characteristics coming into the continent. So I think our view is that the physical molecules with those characteristics should be arriving at the boundary of Europe, and the carbon footprint should be recognized at that delivered point, so including the means of transport. And I think it's also very important that there is consistency in terms of the methodology that carbon footprint and that where relevant renewable characteristics and other topics are applied consistently between that imported product and domestically produced product. But once it's within those boundaries, I think the book and claim approach, separating the certificates, is a way of creating the most value, honestly, for those attributes. And I think the more value that you can create for those attributes, the more incentive you build for production, for supply chains to develop, and for the market to be created. And that's what we really want to deliver. We need to deliver decarbonization of the European and the global economy. Yep. So the easiest, quickest way that we can create clear value to do that, I think, is the best way to the market driver is the most effective way of delivering that.
Okay, so we bring green molecules to Europe, and then the environmental attributes can flow within Europe independently from the physical flows. Good. So, Catherine, and I think you felt it coming. So the IEB, I think it's recognized worldwide at setting a real standard on a robust book and claim system for renewable electricity at first, nowadays also on renewable gases. We've seen that recently the European Parliament, so just to come back, the book and claim system have always been operating within Europe. That has been always the focus. We never really had a big ship with a battery bringing renewable electricity, injecting it into the electricity grid. But now it's biomethane with hydrogen. We feel that the international flows are going to bring green, renewable, clean molecules to our shores. And the European Parliament has voted and asked for the Commission to put in place a formal recognition procedure for Europe to be able to import the GOs, the guarantees of origin, to be coming from other countries. What are, according to you, the prerequisites to enable that from an IEB perspective?
Well, a lot has to be designed still further, but exactly that is the right angle of interest, I would say. You say you import green molecules. That is exactly already the question. You know you import molecules, but are you certain that you import the greenness as well? Of course, everybody likes to claim that. Just so in the past 20 years that AIB has been existing, we have spent the first decade basically on avoiding double counting. And double counting within the certificate system, we've developed the European Energy Certificate System, a multi-energy carrier energy tracking system. Within a certificate system, you can avoid double counting if you design it well, it's just good governance, performance issues, things like that. But then outside of that perfect certificate system, it's still possible to double claim it. And that's where we spent the second decade of AIP's existence on with electricity, basically, to have at least a framework around the guarantee of origin system in Europe that prevents double claiming. You can only claim green electricity consumption, renewable electricity consumption in Europe if a GO, a guarantee of origin, is cancelled for it. And that is definitely a challenge when we extend it to hydrogen, because hydrogen is not only falling under energy regulation in Europe, it falls under more regulation aspects. That's one thing. What you can do at import is definitely require a quality guarantee and standardization, and a standardization framework is exactly what it takes to be recognizing that. And a standardization framework that prevents double issuance, double transfer, double cancellation of these certificates is fantastic, but you also need a mechanism that prevents double claims. Double claims, it needs at least unique proof. So how are you certain that the green molecules that you import from the other side of the world have not yet been claimed as green, or the electricity that with which they were produced has not yet been claimed as green electricity in that country of origin? That is a very important thing, and that needs definitely a unique organization that can issue these certificates. And that also calls for, so in terms of role allocation, you need to be certain that there is only a unique organization providing these unique proofs of greenness, but you also need an integrated system across the energy carriers. And that was that's something that we've been working on in AIB, to use the same mechanism for electricity, gases, hydrogen, and to be able to use the same electronic document structure for the different energy carriers, to have rules to deal with energy carrier conversion. So that's definitely in a cooperation. Of course, you cannot unilaterally determine a cooperation, but you have to agree mutually on the standards criteria, and standardization processes are really things that can make that happen.
Yeah. Over here, we need to avoid double counting. We need to be sure that several on the certificates correct as well.
Yeah.
Daria, you already demonstrated there's so many potential export countries which are trying to developing their own local schemes. Those scheme might be for national usage, it might be for export. But I believe they're potentially unaware about all the specificities of the IEB rules. What is the Hydrogen Council doing to facilitate them? Is there any capacity building foreseen?
Yeah, I think that the checklist that we are working on as part of the study project will be really instrumental, because the idea behind the checklist is really to lay out the core qualifications and core criteria in terms of the design of the certification schemes, to make sure that they are robust enough, meaning that they are relevant governance and oversight criteria being laid out, but also relevant criteria when it comes to the design, sort of design features rather, of the scheme that allow for the schemes to talk to each other, in other words, a level of interoperability between the schemes. So I think that checklist that we are working on as part of the project will really provide a very tangible and a very practical tool for national authorities, or for scheme developers that are, you know, for schemes that are privately owned as well, to be able to look at the practical design features that would enable that, on the one hand, the credibility of the scheme and trustworthiness. Again, building on what you said, Katrine, you know, making sure that they design in such a way that would avoid double counting and make sure that there are robust oversight processes that feed into the functionalities of the scheme. And at the same time, making sure that you can actually, there is a degree of fungibility between the certificates that are issued within the scheme and perhaps a scheme that is developed, let's say, by a national authority within a different jurisdiction, because of, again, the design provisions that you would be able to tick off and put in place. So it's Valerian was saying, in terms of practical tools, I think that the checklist that we are developing as part of the project will be able to provide that.
So whenever a policymaker in a foreign country would like to develop a certification scheme, they should print out this checklist, put it on their desk, and that will be part of their best practices. It will provide them the best practices and make sure that they take all the choices they need to take.
Indeed, that's perfect. Our target.
Maybe Peter, coming back to you, you've been a banker. So we've been talking about geos and how they can be recognized coming from foreign countries. What is the role that sustainability reporting is playing in kickstarting this global trade? What is the role of all of these sustainable finance, like the EU taxonomy? Is this driving Air Liquide? Is this driving your customers to produce clean, green, renewable hydrogen? Could you elaborate on that?
Yes. I mean, there's a huge amount of activity. I mean, we've seen the financial markets have really shifted in terms of the way that they approach climate topics in the last couple of years. I think one of the real points which crystallized a shift in mindset was, I think early last year, the CEO of BlackRock, Larry Fink, said in his letter to CEOs, climate risk is investment risk. And that really shifted what was previously sort of the domain of ESG teams in banks and research departments to bring that into mainstream analysis of companies. And we've seen a lot of corporate response to that worldwide. I think sustainable finance is part of it. I know that we use sustainable finance tools. It does, of course, require us to meet certain criteria, and this is where I think standardization of sustainability reporting is going to become increasingly important as well, because in order to be able to tap into different finance options, in order to be comparable worldwide for around the data that you're reporting, I think this this consistency and standardization of methodology, it goes beyond just certification. It goes actually to the way that we think about the carbon intensity of everything that we do on a daily basis.
Okay. And maybe also putting this question towards Norway and Daria. So we see that corporate reporting might be a very important driver for people to start producing clean or use clean molecules. Currently, I don't think those reporting standards are obligatory or not obligatory in all nations. Today, I think when we talk about financial accounting, we have US GAAP, we have European IAS. Those are obligations. Should we also have obligatory environmental reporting standards? So should we have the reporting standards environmentally? And should they become obligatory? In your view, Noé?
Walter, sorry to be answering like a politician. I want to answer something else. Because I want to circle back to something that I think should be said here. So I want to say it here as namely that I think Europe needs to be very careful with their norms and their standards that they set, and also about certification, etc. I mean, we can make it all very technical, but it's also, if Europe is really wants a partnership, as I'm hearing from Timmermans and from others, I heard it from Jorgo yesterday, a real partnership with the Middle East, with Northern Africa, with India, with South Africa, with Chile, you need to talk to these countries also on a kind of a mutual respect basis. So it cannot be the case that we design what we think in Europe is the perfect system and then say, okay, you need to check that list and you need to check that box and It's not going to work like that. And Europe, if they are truly want this partnership, they should sit down with those countries and work out, okay, we think it should be like this, but what do you guys think, and how does this work for you? Otherwise, we will never get this, you know, this wonderful 10 million tons that we want import. We will never get them. Sorry to answer a totally different question, but Daria is going to answer the other question.
Well, actually, I'm going to first echo you, Noe, and say that this is a great point, and I would just want to echo you and say that we need, it's absolutely critical to have workable and pragmatic qualifications for imports in order to enable those trade flows and to be able to indeed proceed with the implementation of those trade corridors that are envisaged in the Repower EU plan. So if we really want to have that, to hit that 10 million tons target of hydrogen imports by 2030, that means that the qualification requirements have to be, of course, robust, but they also have to be workable and they have to be pragmatic. And that's just towards your point, Noah, which I think is indeed really crucial, and we have heard a lot about this earlier today during the discussions. And coming back to your point, Wouter, I think that indeed, when it comes to, and this also echoes a little bit what you have mentioned, Peter, before, the sustainable finance dimension, that investors are increasingly looking into the environmental attributes of projects. And we see, for example, the emergence of the regulation for sustainable finance in Europe, which provides a practical taxonomy for investors. And interestingly, I would like to link this discussion back to the development of global standards. So in the EU taxonomy for sustainable finance, when it comes to the qualifications for hydrogen manufacturing to be qualified as a sustainable economic activity, the sustainable finance regulation refers to an ISO standard. And I think, indeed, the development of common standards at ISO level and having an ISO standard methodology for the assessment of the carbon footprint of all hydrogen production and transportation pathways based on the IPHA guidelines is absolutely critical. And that, again, reinforces the need for those common underlying standards in order to effectively be able to implement both certification scheme and design certification schemes in the way that is robust, and also have the frameworks and instrument for investors to be able to navigate themselves in the market that is increasingly diverse and based on, again, different hydrogen and hydrogen-based products and transportation pathways. So I think that that's perhaps a nice way to link the discussions that we've been having all together.
If I may, I think there are two things to this discussion, and I think one is the criteria for considering something as green, but on the other hand, there should be clear criteria for considering something as unique. And to be sure about the uniqueness of whatever you attribute you import, that is definitely a question where you cannot just do negotiations on. It's a matter of, are you certain that it hasn't yet been claimed in the country of origin as green? That remains definitely a criterion of focus and of alertness in all the agreements that need to be established. And that does require probably some kind of legislative aspect in the country of origin to avoid leaving the claim behind if the greenness is exported.
Yep. See, unfortunately, the time is already running out. I have quite a lot of follow-up questions. But Jorgo, we're going to round this off. I see already people queuing towards the cocktail party. So, Jorgo, would you like to do the closing of this session, please?
Yes, yes.
That's what my note's saying. Jorgo closes the session.
Thank you very much. Thank you. But I was right. Wouter is the expert. And thanks very much, Wouter, to guide us through this. He deserves an extra applause. I mean, this was really great. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last panel of this 2 days of high-level political conference. It was the first time we did that. And I know that I am in between this panel and the cocktail, the networking cocktail. But I really would like to say a few words only, about the very fact that we did this partly firework of announcements, of ideas, of panel discussions here. It all has to do with the courage that we took as Hydrogen Europe together with our partners but we could rely on a very professional person, a very professional lady. And I would like to just highlight that this all would not have been possible without one person day and night being available for the whole team, for many of you, to bring this together. And this lady is Tina Marold. She's here. She's shy. Too shy. No, this is Tina. And when I entered this morning,
hello.
when I entered this morning here, this big hall, because yesterday it was not there, I was saying, is that Hydrogen Europe here? Is that so? It thanks very much to all of you, but thanks to you, Tina, because it was your idea, it was your courage to really push it through. Sometimes we thought, whoa, what are we doing here? But yes. This is it. Yes, and. We survived. She will get, she doesn't know yet, but she will get a special bonus. I will tell her. Special bonus.
Where is it?
No, it's something, it's very tangible, but it has to do with relaxing for more than one day. For a whole week, so you will get extra holidays for that. And you can relax because she could not relax all over so many weeks. So, again, thanks very much, and after that, we go outside and have an area. Stay here. Thank you. Here, the whole team is there. See, that's Hydrogen Europe team came in for you. And now let's have a drink, or many drinks, outside at the floor. So in all the areas where you can get food, you will be invited for this evening. Thank you very much indeed.
And enjoy the next couple of days, of course.